So, Father, we come one more time to you tonight. Actually, it's not the last time, but Lord, we come before you tonight. We ask that you would speak to us in your word. Lord, we thank you for the word of God. We thank you that we come into this place not to hear from a man, but to hear from you. And Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit would open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts and our minds to understand your will, your ways, your desire for our life. And Lord, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. And together we all said, amen. Amen. Well, today I want to talk to you on a little subject called the setup. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to John in the 5th chapter, John chapter 5. We're going to talk about the setup. A couple of weeks ago, my wife and I were able to be part of a good friend of mine. He was finally going to ask his girlfriend to marry him, and they had been planning and scheming, and my wife and him were going through all sorts of different Pinterest pages and Googling. I mean, they actually Googled, like, how to propose, and, like, all these different ideas came up. I mean, they had, like, a board that they were putting together of just things to do, and unbeknownst to her, my friend's girlfriend, unbeknownst to her, he was planning this setup, and so we were able to take part and set up all of these different things, and, you know, of course, it was, like, the hottest day. You remember that heat wave a couple of weeks back? It was like the hottest day of the year thus far, and we had all these different supplies and all these heavy materials that we went out into this park, and you'd set up this really beautiful array, kind of eclectic country, you know, birch bark trees and signs painted on burlap, marry me. And so we found this really pretty little nook at this park in Redlands, and there we are, my wife and I and a couple other people from the church. We were setting up all of this this display, and he was taking her out, and they were going for a walk, and he told her, you know, like, well, let's go hang out at the park today. So she didn't know, and so we were able to just join together and put our forces together, and we set this thing up. It was really beautiful. We got all these things going, and she had no clue. It was really awesome. Right at that setup, right as she was walking in, you know, he texted us like, hey, we're on our way. And so we're all like getting ready, trying to hide in our television, or our media department director Monica, she's hiding in one bush trying to take pictures, and I didn't have time to get out, so I jumped into these bushes of bamboo. And as I'm in these bamboo bushes, you hear the sound of people coming up, and you walk in, and you're like, oh, this is it. They're ready to go. And then all of a sudden, look down, and it's a guy and his girlfriend, but it's not my friend. So, like, I'm like, hey, you know, out of the bamboo. And he's like, the guy's like all started looking around, like, just somebody yelled at me in the bushes. I'm like, hey. And so he like makes eye contact with me in the bushes, and I'm like, hey, get out of here. And he's just like, what's going on? And so he's like, oh, you know, like probably some creepers in the bush right now doing drugs. Is that Pastor Luke doing drugs in the bamboo? And so anyways, so they go like running away all awkwardly, and like literally a second later, my friend and his girlfriend, they come and they walk around the corner, and of course, like, the moment gets super tender, and you can just hear her start to, like, you know, snivel up, and I knew it, and she starts crying, and he's crying, and it's an emotional moment, and everybody's taking pictures, and everybody's hugging, and Stacy jumps out, and she's like, yeah! And it was like the ultimate setup. I mean, like, just to be a part of that, it went so well. You know, when you think of what a setup is a lot of things. Today, in the context of the setup, I want to talk about the follow-through, or the idea of putting together an elaborate plan to bring two people or something together at the right time. You know, we've all been set up in places in our life and in times of our life. Maybe you've been set up in a good way. Maybe you were set up with your wife or your husband. Or maybe you were set up in a bad way and you had a friend that said, I have a friend that I want to set you up with. And you were like, don't ever set me up again ever after this. And, you know, we've all been set up in life. But, you know, the thing is that ultimately, when it comes down to life, there's a lot of things that happen. And there's a lot of things that happen beyond our control. And there's a lot of things that happen beyond our understanding. And the Bible is full of stories of setups where God set up the perfect time and the perfect person for the perfect season of their lives. And today I want to take you, I had you go with me to the book of John, to a season of a setup with God. And I believe it's a unique setup. This is a story that's only found in John. And there's a story, it's kind of vague as far as the details of the person that we know. But we're going to look at John in the 5th chapter. And I want to just pick up in verse number 2. And we're going to read verse number 2 through verse number 9. And we're going to read this story of a setup. And I just want to quickly tonight just take some time and just, I believe, just talk what God has been putting on my heart about the ultimate setup in life. And it says in verse number 2, now there was in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having 5 porches. So around this pool, there are five porches or five areas in which you could loiter or you could hang around. And so there, we see that there's a lot of room around this pool. And so it has five porches. And in these porches, or in these five, lay a great multitude of sick people. Blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. So here John paints this picture as he's talking about the story that he saw with Jesus. And you see this pool. And on this pool, you just imagine five terraces or five areas or lounging areas around this pool or this reservoir in the city of Jerusalem where people would wait and they would gather and the water would stir. And you'll see in just a moment what the story about the stirring is. And it says in verse number 4 that an angel would come down at a certain time into the pool and stir up the water. And then whoever stepped into it first, after the stirring of the water, was made well of whatever disease he had. And so we see this really unique, interesting story of the move of God in this pool of Bethesda. And so they would stand and they would gather and people would come by the droves to sit at these porches and at these areas to loiter and to wait. And then there would be a move of God and God would send his angel, a messenger down, and he would stir up the water and the water would become turbulent. And as the water became turbulent, that was a sign for all of these people who were suffering various afflictions in life that the very first person, like this rat race into the pool, whoever could get into the water first would find themselves healed by the presence of God. What a unique story of a move of God. And so it goes on and it says, now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. 38 years he was sick. The Bible doesn't tell us what his infirmity was. The Bible doesn't tell us his name. The Bible doesn't tell us anything about it other than the fact that he was sick for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there, and he knew that he had already been in that condition a long time, he said to him, do you want to be made well? The sick man answered to him, sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I'm coming, another one steps down in before me. And Jesus says to him, rise, take your bed and walk. And immediately, verse number 9, the man was made well. He took up his bed and he walked. And that day was the Sabbath. And then the rest of that story talks about the Pharisees and the religious coming and trying to find a reason to persecute Jesus for healing on the Sabbath. But here is a time or a sign, a story that we see in the Bible of a setup from God. And as we look at this story, we see that there's this gathering place of the sick. There's this gathering place of the afflicted. There's this gathering place of the disabled and the societal rejects because they could not contribute to the agrarian society at the time. They had nowhere else to go but to gather in this place. And there was a great multitude, the Bible says. But then the Bible, John and his story begins to focus and single out this one person, this man. And the Bible says that he had an infirmity. Now that word infirmity in the Greek literally means to be incapacitated. So this wasn't a man that was suffering from a cold, or this wasn't a man that was suffering from something that was inconvenient to his life. Whatever was afflicting this man was incapacitating him to do and to live a regular and a normal life. And so there, for 38 years, this guy waited. He waited. He stood there at the pool waiting for his moment. Every time the angel of the Lord would stir the water, he would jump up or try to get up and move. But before he could get there, somebody else got there before him. Or when it was his time to get up, he'd try to get up and there was nobody to help him. I mean, you think about that story and just what this story has to do with our own story in life. And this man's story sounds a lot like just life in general. When we go through the course of life and we live day to day and we go through all the different things that happen to us in life, how many know there are so many times when it seems like it's one setback after the next, setback after the next setback. I mean, this guy's story is that whenever it was his time to get up and go, he would start moving and somebody would go before him. It seems like when we're waiting on God for something, We're waiting and we're saying, God, I'm waiting on that promise. God, I'm waiting on that word. God, I'm waiting on the revelation of what the preacher was talking about on that Sunday service to come true in my life. And we look around and it's like somebody comes before us and they get the gift and the move of God. And we're there once again waiting. He was there waiting and watching. And every time there was an opportunity for him to be healed or to receive life with the move of God, there was nobody around to help. Don't you know that sometimes it seems like in the greatest of times you've got all the people that you need in life, but it seems like when the stuff hits the fan, it's like, where is everybody else in my life? I mean, this guy was living life, but on a harder scale than you and I. Setback after setback, missed opportunity after missed opportunity in his life. And the Bible tells us that he sat there for 38 years. I mean, think about this for a moment. Just think about the ultimate torture of this man's life. For 38 years, he saw the move of God. For 38 years, he saw the healing power of God. And he watched, and he attempted, and he failed. And he watched, and he attempted, and he failed. And he watched, and he attempted, and he didn't make it. And he experienced a setback after setback after setback. Not for months, not for weeks, for 38 years of his life. He watched God move, and the move of God was out of reach for him. Talk about a hard life. I mean, think about it. If I try to put myself in this man's condition, if I try to put myself in this man's shoes, think about how many moments of this man's life, think about how many hours, think about how many days were spent in his life wondering and reflecting back, if I only would have been a little bit closer, if I only would have taken one more step, if I only would have got up to drink a little bit of water right at the right time. If there only would have been somebody there to help me get onto my feet. If there could have been, what if I? And he starts to feed himself and he starts to remind himself and he starts to reflect on all of his life, watching out on the missed opportunities of the move of God. You can imagine that there'd be a great sense of despair. You can imagine that there'd be a great sense of lost hope. And you can imagine that after 38 years of waiting, you would grow weary and tired of wondering, is something ever going to happen? I can say in my own life, and periods far shorter, I haven't even been alive for 38 years, of crying out to God, God, where were you in that moment of my life? God, where were you when I was standing on your promises and I felt like I needed you to be there and it seems like nothing happened? God, where were you when everybody's in front of me getting blessed and I'm waiting in the back of the line and it doesn't get to me? God, where were you when I could see you moving in everybody else's life, but it seemed like it was out of reach? I've been there in my own life. My relationships, I've been there with my kids. I've been there in ministry here in the church. I've been there in all sorts of different areas. God, where were you? And I think each and every one of us, when we look at our lives, we can look back at times and seasons, and maybe you're in one right now, where it seems like hope is starting to wane, and it seems like the solutions are starting to drift away, and it seems like I'm never going to get out of this. I'm never going to overcome this. I'm never going to go beyond this. My kids are never going to move beyond this phase. I don't see anything happening that's going to make anything any better. 38 years this man waited. How many others do you think this man saw come and go? How many people do you think this man saw in 38 years come and get the move of God in their life and go? And yet there he was, incapacitated at life. A prisoner of his own ailments, unable to fend for himself. How many people do you think that he sat with in his connection, in his relationship, in time of waiting for the angel to stir? How many people do you think that he saw leave without hope? How many people do you think that he saw, you know what, I'm better off sitting at the gate begging for the rest of my life than trying to sit here and get a move of God? How many people did he see give up in life, lose hope? When we look around in our city, when we look around in our nation, when we look around in our world, hope wanes. We look around and things aren't getting better, they're getting worse. Things are getting darker, things are getting more polarized. Things are starting to change for a direction that we, the church, say, what is going on? And we wait and we wait and we wait and we see people get blessed in front of us. We see people take our spot. We see people reach out when we need help. There's nobody there. We see people all around us losing hope and giving up because of their lost hope. And we wait and we wait and we wait for 38 years. He waited. He waited. But then, in one day, a man came to that pool. A humble man, the Bible says. Not of great looks, of great stature. A man that looked just like anybody else. A humble rabbi from Judea and Galilee came. And in one day, something happened. You see, God came to that pool, but not to stir the waters like he had before. The Bible says that there was a great multitude of people at that pool waiting for the move of God. And for 38 years, this guy watched and he waited and he sat there hoping and waiting for his time to come. And then one day, a humble rabbi from Judea walked into the room with a great multitude of people and he singled this man out. And he walked up to this man. And the Bible says in John, it said that Jesus saw him lying there and he knew that he had already been in that condition for a long time. You see, for 38 years, this guy was waiting. For 38 years, it was setback after setback after setback after setback in his life. But in one day, God came to move at that pool once again, but this time not to stir up the waters of the pool, but rather to single out the man who had been waiting on God. The divine setup. And I love it as I can just picture and I can imagine the smile in Jesus' heart when he goes to this man and he asks him the question, do you want to be made whole? You know, have you ever asked somebody a question that you knew the answer to? You don't ask the question because you're seeking an answer. You're asking the question. Why? Because you want them to realize and recognize what's going to happen. And that they would open their eyes. And I think, and if I could picture it in my own mindset, I have this image of Jesus in his heart smiling to this man because this is the moment of the divine setup of God. And Jesus, amidst the whole multitude of people waiting to be healed by God, Jesus walks up to this one man and he asks him, do you want to be healed? In my heart, I imagine that I could just see Jesus kneel down beside him and in his heart just say to him, are you ready for your setup? Are you ready for your setup? Because your time has come. And the man replies, I have missed so many opportunities. I want to be healed, sir. There ain't nobody to help. And Jesus says, this is your moment. This is your time. For 38 years, you're waiting and your setbacks have been all a setup for this divine moment. That God would show up to single you out. You see, church, what we can learn from this message and we can learn from this story in our own lives as we go through life and we experience disappointments and we experience setups of good and bad and we experience all sorts of different setbacks in our life is to understand that the setbacks that you and I experience in life are the setups for God's supernatural or superior plan. The setbacks in our life are the setups of God's superior plan. You see, Think about it for a moment. What if in 38 years this man would have made it to the water? Well, that would have been good. If he would have made it to the water in 38 years, what would have happened? He could have dipped his body in that water and what? Got out and walked out of that place a healed man. Rejoined society. Entered into the workforce. Made a living for himself for the years that he had left on earth. And that would have been a good story. But let me tell you something. God had a plan. And his plan wasn't for this man to have a good story. God said, I want this man to have a great story. And he might have tried to live according to his plan. But God's plan was superior. Why? Because 38 years of setbacks led him to the setup where he got to look God in creation, God in human form, when he got to look into the eyes that created the heavens and the earth, when he got to look and experience the physical and audible voice of the Savior of the world. Speak to him the words, get up, your setup is now. You see, his story would have been good to have been healed, but his story is great. Why? Because Jesus came into his story. And any story with Jesus in it is a great story. And you see, God has a story for you. And God has a story for me. And we don't know anything about this man. We don't know his name. We don't know what his ailment was. We don't know what his profession was after his ailment. We don't know how long he lived after this. All we know is that this was the story of a man who had setbacks and disappointments and lost hope in his life. But God was waiting for the moment of divine setup in which Jesus Christ would come and single him out and say, I've got a plan for your life. And my plan is for you and me to know each other and for you to get up and walk through life. So your setbacks are just setups for God's superior plan. Why? Because you and I, we want to live according to the plan of our life. But God says, listen, that's a good plan. And you might have a good life, but I don't want you to live a good life. I want you to live a great life with Jesus Christ. But we get wrapped up in disappointment, and we get wrapped up in discouragement, we get wrapped up in the here, and we get wrapped up in the now. We begin to wane, and we begin to lose hope, and as we begin to lose hope, we begin to forget about hope, and when we forget about our hope, we begin to forget to hope, and when we forget to hope, the empathy that God has placed on our heart for his plan and his will turns to apathy for the world. We become closed and we become shut off and we become distant. We just try to survive through life instead of thrive with Jesus Christ. Don't ever lose hope and allow your empathy of what God has given to you on your heart to turn to apathy for this world. Why? Because we as Christians, we as the body of Christ, have got to always continue to look at the hope of Jesus Christ as our divine setup in life. The book of Hebrews tells us in the 10th chapter, the writer of Hebrews was writing and he says these words. He says, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. Why? He who is promised is faithful. He who has promised is faithful. You see, you might be going through a period of setbacks. I know some friends of mine right now have been going through some hard times and my heart breaks for what they've been going through. It seems like one missed opportunity after the next missed opportunity after the next missed opportunity. And when an opportunity arises, somebody else jumps in front of them and takes the opportunity. And God says, church, if you're going through hell, keep going. If you're going through the valley of shadow of death, keep going. Why? Because you might be living through some setbacks right now in life. You might be facing some setbacks with your kids right now. You might be facing some setbacks with your finances. You might be facing some setbacks with your marriage. But listen, God says you keep holding on to the hope of Jesus Christ because your setbacks are going to be the setup for God's superior plan in your life. And God has a plan for you. Like Jeremiah, the 29th chapter says, God says, I know the thoughts, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Thoughts to succeed, thoughts to prosper you. Don't let your setups take you back. Let us hold fast to this confession. As we recognize that God's setups or the setups that we experience in life are the setbacks or the setups for God's superior plan, church, don't look at your setbacks, but look to the setup. Don't look at your setbacks. Look to your setup. You see, so often we allow our scars, we allow the things that have happened to us, we allow the hurts and the pains that we have experienced in our life to define who we are and to make the decisions and to lead us and direct us in the decisions and the way that we walk in the rest of our life. And so we look back at our past and we say, well, this is who I am and this is a part of me and I'll never forget it. Just like that man, when Jesus came and he asked him, do you want to be healed? Think about it for a moment. The man's reply to Jesus was, sir, I have missed every opportunity. And when I have tried, people have gone before me. And when I got up, there was nobody there to help me do these. You don't understand. I have so many setbacks in my life. I don't even know what healing is. But he didn't realize something at that very moment, that it was Jesus Christ who was standing right next to him, asking him the question. He had not yet been and seen the moment of his divine setup. It was the very next words that came out of Jesus' mouth that all of a sudden pointed him to the direction of God's plan for his life, when Jesus said, "Get up, take up your bed and walk." And all of a sudden, boom, his eyes weren't fixed on what was any longer. His eyes were fixed on what is and is to come, Jesus Christ. Like Hebrews says, the author and the finisher of our faith. I love how Paul says in the book of 2 Corinthians in the first chapter, verse number 20, I'll put it up on the New Living Translation. Paul says it like this. Paul says, "For all of God's promises have been fulfilled in Christ with a resounding yes, and through Christ our amen," which means yes, ascends to God for his glory. So when we read a promise in the Word of God and we look to our setup in life rather than looking at our setbacks, we say, "God, is that promise for me?" And God says, "Yes." And we say, "Yes. God, is that promise for me?" "Yes." Well, then I say, "Yes, I'm not going to look at my setbacks. I'm going to look at my setup, because I know that there's a time when Jesus Christ is going to intervene on my life, and all of a sudden everything that happened to me in the past will be no longer, because I will be dead, and now I'm facing the future, because his promises are yes, and our response is amen." What has God promised to you? God promises to you eternal salvation. God promises to you salvation for your children. God promises to you peace. God promises to you deliverance. God promises to you that the devil will run. God promises to you the deliverance from fear. God promises to you guidance in Psalms. He promises to you wisdom in James. He promises to you his presence in trouble. He promises to you deliverance and temptation. He promises to you. And the Bible says that his promises are yes, and our response is amen. You might be going through some setbacks, but they're just set ups for Jesus Christ to come into your life and say, "My promises were fulfilled on the cross of Calvary, and now it's time." And the 38 years of waiting are going to be like nothing to you anymore, because now you're living in the promises of Jesus Christ. And so we can live our life like that man, trying to live according to our plan and our desires and our wishes. And we can try to reach out for the opportunity that comes our way. And it just might be that you grab a hold of an opportunity. But like that man, if he would have got that opportunity to get into the pool and be healed, he would have never met Jesus. And so like that man, God said, "I got a plan for you." And you've been feeling disappointed and discouraged and forgotten and ignored. But God says, "I'm just waiting for that perfect time when you and my will, when you and my promise, when you and my word, when you and my Holy Spirit, when you and my presence, when you and my power, when you and my Son converge and everything comes into alignment, and all of a sudden everything that you were going through is nothing and everything that you look to is everything, because now you've got a setup in Jesus Christ." You know, Paul was a man that knew all about setups. He was set up literally in the bad and in the good, betrayed. Paul knew all about discouragement and derailment. Paul knew all about hardships and life. If there's anybody that knew trouble, Paul lists about all the trouble that he's seen. Literally, the guy singing, "Nobody knows the trouble I've seen." And Paul in Romans, the 8th chapter, verse number 18, I love what Paul says. Paul says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us." Paul says, "I consider that the setbacks of my life will not even pale in comparison to the moment of my setup with Jesus Christ." And I love it. 10 verses down, we'll just leapfrog right there. And verse number 28, Paul says it like this. And he says, and we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God and who are called according to his purpose. Church, there is a divine setup coming your way. God has a call. God has a plan. God has a purpose. And Paul says, what you're dealing with right now are just the setups for my divine plan in your life. All you got to do, stop looking at your setbacks and start looking to your setup in Jesus Christ. So that we look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. Why? So that we could experience the setup in our life. I mean, think about it like this. That's the story of salvation, John, the fifth chapter. What do you mean? A sick man, the story of salvation? This is the Messiah story right here. Humanity incapacitated by sin. Constantly seeing and viewing the move of God, but never able to reach God. So close, yet so far away. A hopeless situation. Who will help us? Who will lead us? There's nobody there to bring us to God. And then God, in his divine moment, in his divine setup, brought Jesus Christ, born of a virgin at the time, at the fullness of time. Why? For the divine setup to come to humanity. And like it said in the book of John in the fifth chapter, Jesus knew the man's condition and how long he had been sick. Jesus knows the story of humanity and how long they have been disconnected. And yet he comes in the time of setup and he says to humanity, because of who I am and because of what I have done, rise up, take up your bed, and no longer be incapacitated with sin, but now be reconnected and reunited to God. It's the story of salvation. Which means with Jesus Christ in your life, you've already had one divine setup. If you've got Jesus, you've already been set up by God. And God says, I got many more coming your way. All you got to do is look, hold fast to the promises, for he who promised is faithful in your life. Don't give up. Don't give in. Keep going, because your setbacks are just setups for God's superior plan. He's got a plan. He's got a call. He's got a purpose for your life. Maybe those of you in this place today, you say, you know what, I haven't been set up. My life is all about setbacks. It seems like everything I do is a mistake, and everything I've gone through has just been a setback after setback after setback. And I'm just waiting, and I'm just wondering, and I'm just hoping, and I'm just desiring that at some point in my life, things are going to turn around for me. Well, Jesus in the book of Revelation, speaking to a church, Jesus says these words. He says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And he says, he who opens the door, I will come into him and he will come into me and we will be together. We will be reunited and united together. And I believe tonight you are here for a setup of God. You've been living setbacks, waiting for your life to turn around. And today is the setup that God has for your life to see everything begin to change in your life. Maybe you've been in that place, maybe you're in that place right now where you look at your life and you look at the circumstances of your life and you look at everything around you and you say, you know what, I forgot that there was hope. And because I forgot that there was hope, I forgot to hope. And my life has turned from empathy of others to apathy around me. And I'm just cold and empty on the inside and longing for something to return to me. You see, humanity has been separated from God by sin from the very beginning. The Bible says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Nobody had to teach you and I how to lie. Nobody had to teach us how to cheat. Nobody had to teach you how to steal. You figured that out on your own at a very early age. But the Bible says that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. You see, God, with a divine setup to humanity, sent his son Jesus to die on a cross for our sin, for our shame, for our burdens, for our setbacks, for our disappointments. For all the things that we've done that were wrong, for all the things that we've done that were mess ups, for everything that we've done, God sent Jesus Christ to bear that weight, to bear that shame, so that we could be set up with God as a new creation, the Bible says. old things passed away, all things becoming new. You see, that setup doesn't come because you attend church. That setup doesn't come on you because of a mindset. That setup doesn't come because of a hope or a desire. That setup doesn't come because of a sense of religion. That setup only comes with a belief in Jesus Christ and the acceptance and surrender of your heart and your life to Him. You see, Jesus was talking to a man in the book of John a few chapters earlier from what we read today. And Jesus says to this man, Nicodemus, who was a religious man, a great man, and it was a divine setup in Nicodemus' life. And Jesus says these words to Nicodemus. He says, in order to inherit, in order to get set up into the kingdom of God, He says, you must be born again. You see, born again, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. It's not what Hollywood and culture has made it out to be. We think of born again, we think of those crazy, weirdo, out of control Christians, but from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word, it's always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. What does that mean? It means that if you've given God all of your heart, you've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, in the very same scriptures that I was talking about, Jesus knocking on the door of your heart, Jesus is speaking to a church. People that you would think would be doing all the good things, and as a matter of fact, His statements say you think that you're clothed with righteousness, you think that you're beautiful and you think that you're rich, but He says you don't realize how naked and how destitute you are. He says, oh, I wish that you would come to Me, for I know your works. He says, I'd rather find that you're hot, I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I'll vomit you from My mouth. A shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus Christ. And what He's saying is that lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all, but they'll be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means, in terms of your relationship with Jesus Christ, that you've got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs and your occasional church attendance, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. Listen, you're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. You're kind of riding the fence somewhere in the middle, doing a lot of your thing, doing a lot of God, some of God's thing. You kind of, you know, doing the church thing when you come to church, doing the world thing when you're outside of church. And Jesus says, listen, not going to make it with that mindset. You're not going to make it with that life. But the beautiful thing is the following statement is what I said. As He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. You see, that doesn't have to be your destiny. The emptiness and the loneliness and the setbacks and the disappointment and the lost hope that you've experienced in the course of your life, that doesn't have to be the rest of your life. Why? Because God has brought you for a setup with Jesus Christ. A season and a time to bring you hope. Jesus said that He has come that you and I would have life and that we would have it abundantly. But it comes by giving our life to Jesus Christ because He laid His life down for us. Today I want to give you the opportunity to receive that gift of salvation all across this auditorium. We don't want to do it some well-meaning church committee or author's way. Let's do it today God's way. And Jesus said these words. He says that if you confess Him before men, He will confess you before His Father. But if you deny Him, He says, He will deny you. The decision's yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He won't force His way or make His way. It's your choice today. And I believe that the Spirit of God is knocking on the door of your heart, saying you've had a lot of setbacks. You've had a lot of disappointments. You've had a lot of failures. You've had a lot of lost hope in your life. But today I'm knocking on your hope with a message of restoration, a message of life, a message of fulfillment, a message of a whole new way. And it starts today by accepting that invitation. So here's what we're going to do in just a moment. I'll count to three. I'll go like this. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And when I smack my hands together, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm asking you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Pastor Luke, I feel the leading. I feel the knocking of the Spirit of God on my heart. I feel Him speaking to me right now saying it's time for me to choose life in Jesus and respond to that invitation. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. Just shortly thereafter, we'll pray a prayer of salvation together. And what you're doing, you're saying, that's me. I want to respond to that invitation of Jesus Christ. And I want to give my heart and I want to give my life to Jesus. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge you. Put it right back down. I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm not here to single you out. I'm not here to poke fun at you. My life's purpose is to be here to build you up. And today, the wisest decision that you can make is to accept the invitation of Jesus Christ through His Holy Spirit right now in your heart. To respond to Jesus, to say, I want life. I want eternal life in heaven. I want the ultimate setup of promises of God, and I want life here on earth. Receive that invitation today. If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus, if that's you, in just a moment, get ready. If you're not sure, listen, make sure. I've heard so many people tell me, Pastor Luke, I hope so or I think so. Did you know that the Bible tells us that God has given us His Spirit on the inside of us? as his seal of approval for us. You don't need to walk through life wondering and hoping, am I right with God? Am I going to go to heaven? God says, no, I have my Spirit of God on the inside of you so that you would know without a shadow of a doubt that you are sons of the Most High God. If you've been living lukewarm, running from God instead of to God, if that's you in just a moment, get ready. You pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down and we'll pray together right afterwards. But today, if that's you in this place, it's time for you to make that commitment. You've had doctors and dentist appointments, a divine appointment, a divine setup today for your life to accept life in Jesus Christ. All over this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, side to side, you guys in the family rooms, I can see you through the windows over there. Maybe you're around the campus watching on the closed circuit television or even at home on the live stream, wherever you're at. This is your moment. This is your time. The day of your salvation is here today. Don't waste another minute. If that's you in this place, as soon as I count to three, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. And we'll go forward together from there. You ready? I'm going to count to three. If that's you, this is your moment. This is your time. Respond to God's invitation in your life. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four. I see you. Five, six. I see you back there. Six wise people. Seven. I see you over there, my man. Seven wise people. Anybody else in this place? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Hey, I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, that's me today. Anybody else today? Anybody else in this place today? Seven wise people or so. Oh, I got you back there in the back. All right, my man Lionel's got you. Eight wise people. Anybody else? Where you at, number nine? Where you at, number 10? Saying, man, I wonder if that's me. I got you, my man. Number nine, where you at? I see that hand back over there. Number 10, number 11. I see you guys over there. All right. Spirit of God's knocking on your heart saying it's time. All you got to do is open the door and receive Jesus today. And that's what you're saying I'm going to do. Anybody else in this place today? I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Move forward today. I'm going to close it down right now. Let's give the Lord a great big praise for 11 or so wise people. It's awesome. Awesome. All 11 of you, maybe you're number 12, 13, 14, 15. You said, I should have done that. I felt like there was something going on in my heart. I had butterflies, but I just didn't respond. Listen, if you raise your hand, say we're going to pray a prayer of salvation. You don't get saved by raising your hand. Say, I want to give my heart to Jesus by raising my hand. Now it's time to follow through. Listen, every decision requires action. You know this. Any decision without action is no decision at all. Nothing will change because you didn't act on that decision. So here's what we're going to do in just a moment. We're all going to stand. And as we stand together, my friend over here, Elijah, is going to sing. As Elijah sings, if you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand or a friend of yours raise your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible. A friend, if you need a friend, come with somebody. Or if you came with somebody, look at them and say, come on, go with me. Or, hey, come on, I'll go with you. Let's go together. I want you to get out of your seat, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here at this altar because we're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So if that's you in this place, you stand to your feet. Come on and meet me right here. Let's change destinies today. This is your setup. You come, if that's you, come on. This is your time. This is your moment. We'll wait for you. Come on. Still coming, come on. We'll wait for you. We'll celebrate with you. Awesome. Hey guys, congratulations. You're making the very best decision you could possibly make. I mean, think about it for a moment. You are choosing eternal life with Jesus Christ. That is a great decision to make. Congratulations. Maybe you've had a life full of disappointments and setbacks, but let me be the first person today to tell you, good job. You're doing a good job. Listen, you know what? It might have been full of disappointment and lost hope, but right now, you're making that setup, chasing that setup with Jesus Christ. and everything in your life is about to change. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. Here's what we're going to do. I said we were going to pray a prayer of salvation. So Joel's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on, but he's going to take you in a real nice intimate place where you can get alone with God and just take a moment and give your heart and life to Jesus Christ by inviting him into your heart, inviting Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior of life through a prayer. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information, some literature. As you walk out of here, you say, what do I do next? We're going to point you in the right direction and say, hey, this is how to live, and this is what God wants, his plan for your life. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want to connect you with somebody here at the church that will meet with you right before a church service. They'll buy you a cup of coffee at our cafe, or if you come on a Sunday morning when we have our cafe open with food, they'll get you some french fries or something like that. Sit down with you for a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for his plan in your life. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend. Congratulations.